It's time right now for the David Feldman Show. He's talking politics and comedy too. He'll tell a dirty joke if you want him to. He's just a lefty from way back. He's a union man with an Emmy for writing. Someday he's mad and he feels like fighting. It's time right now for the David Feldman Show. So get your ears on right, buckle in real tight. He's got a lot to say and he's coming your way. Time right now for the David Feldman Show. So get your ears on right and buckle in real tight. He's got a lot to say and he's coming your way. He's got a lot to say and he's coming your way. He's got a lot to say and he's coming your way.
Welcome to An Evening with Dr. Jen. We decided that it's time to talk about something other than Donald Trump and the end of empire. And what better way to lighten the mood on a Saturday night is to be joined by Dr. Jennifer Verdolin, animal behaviorist, author of Raised by Animals. Please say hello to everybody's favorite doctor, Dr. Jennifer Verdolin. And since we're going to be talking about birds, I figured we'd need a wingman. Please welcome American hero, Bert Ross. On today's show, An Evening with Dr. Jen, we're going to talk about consciousness and other species, because obviously ours is lacking that. We're going to talk about how this pandemic is impacting wildlife, what we can learn from other animals, and what wild animals get up to when they think no one's watching. And we'll be taking calls from our Zoom room. No topic is off limits. Hello, Dr. Jennifer Verdolin.
Hi, I'm so excited about this. So thank you for putting this together. And well, thanks everybody for coming.
Yeah, we have some guests in our Zoom audience who love Dr. Jen. Dr. Jennifer Verdolin is an internationally recognized animal behavior expert writer. She is the author of two books that everybody should pick up: Raised by Animals, The Surprising New Science of Animal Family Dynamics with Try-at-Home Lessons from the Wild, and Wild Connection, What Animal Courtship and Mating Tell Us About Human Relationships. Now, Dr. Jennifer Verdolin is going to give a book away tonight. Is that correct?
I am. So we have a little contest running and I only have two copies left of Wild Connection. And so I decided that we have a little contest and the winner will get a copy. You can have a hard copy or I can send an audiobook depending on whatever the winner prefers.
And feel free to participate in the chat room. You have to caption a picture that Dr. Jennifer Verdolin took yesterday. Can we see the picture, Dan? There we go. So what is that actually before we start the contest?
So we've got a butterfly and then we have a honeybee.
I see. And we're having a caption contest. You were trying to take a picture of a beautiful monarch? Is that a monarch?
I believe it is a monarch, but I'm not a butterfly expert. So, you know, but I believe it is a monarch. But there's a lot of mimics of monarchs, so that's tricky. So, it was having breakfast. I mean, you know, I think there was enough nectar to go around. And then this, I was filming and this unexpected bee came on the scene and it kind of gave me the inspiration for sharing some other photos of sort of animals gone wild and what they get up to when they think no one's watching.
Yes. Now, is a bee a kleptoparasite? Last week you taught us about kleptoparasites. Is a bee a kleptoparasite? And what is a kleptoparasite? Let's ask Bert Ross. I should introduce, let me give Bert Ross a proper introduction because he's sulking there because I'm getting all the attention.
No, I just want to know why I don't have a show. I mean, I really like Dr. Jen, but you know, what's my show?
This is not the time.
I've known you for many, many years. He never even implied that maybe I should have a show, but it's okay. I'm not jealous. It's all right, Doctor.
Bert Ross let me just introduce Bert Ross. Growing up, I had two heroes. My father told me I have two heroes, Ralph Nader, and in a distant second, Bert Ross, a far distant second, Bert Ross, who was the youngest mayor of Fort Lee, New Jersey. He stood up to the mob. He turned down a $500,000 bribe from the mafia and shut down the Gambino family. Personally, I would have taken the money, but what are you going to do? He became energy czar of New Jersey, where he created the right turn on red. Let's get, thank you. That deserves an applause. And for some reason, he is now a humor columnist for the Malibu Times, where you can read him. And I have this book, The Bribe, which tells the story of Bert Ross standing up to the Gambino family and then going into hiding and working with the FBI. The Bribe, written by journalist Philip Ross, not Philip Roth, Philip Ross. Let me just give you a description. This is what the great columnist and historian Richard Reeves says about The Bribe. The Bribe is one of the most revealing books ever written about American politics because at its worst, politics is about money. That's why one mayor can be offered a $500,000 bribe. This time, the mayor, Bert Ross, turned it down, which makes The Bribe one hell of a story. And Bert Ross is some kind of crazy Jewish Serpico. A crazy Jewish Serpico. That's who.
I'd rather be an animal behaviorist.
Well, that's what we're going to talk about. And also, since Bert is obsessed with animals, Dr. Jen said, why don't you have the mayor, Bert Ross, on the show with us so we can Absolutely. Talk about animals.
So I just want to say that bees are not kleptoparasites.
Well, let's ask Bert Ross, okay, since he turned in a kleptoparasite. Why don't you try to guess what kleptoparasite means?
Klepto sounds like thievery.
Right.
And parasite is, we know what a parasite is. So it's a parasite that's thieving, robbing from the one it's hanging on to. Is any of that true?
It's totally true. No, you're amazing, right? So klepto, we might be familiar with kleptomaniac, right? Yeah. People who steal, like who can't help but steal. And so kleptoparasite, exactly. So in the animal kingdom, you know, when we're not talking about, well, humans are animals, when we're talking about other animals, kleptoparasite is basically a strategy that some individuals use where they let you do all the hard work and then they just take it from you.
I love it. I love the concept.
Now, we weren't going to talk about politics tonight.
I know. I was just going to say, like, we have, you know, parasite, klepto, parasite. but it's not a strategy that within a species, even the one like cuckoos and others that essentially do it very frequently, it's never 100%, and no individual within a species uses that strategy 100% of the time. So that's where we're different. We definitely have some individuals who use the strategy 100% of the time. But in other species, they sort of have, you know, a bag of tools, not just a one trick sort of pony.
Yes. So we're going to have a competition in the chat room here in the David Feldman Show Zoom room. If you would like to caption this photograph taken by Dr. Jennifer Verdolin, we will announce the winner on Monday, because we're going to have it's very competitive in the chat room. We have some brilliant people, but it's a hard one to caption, quite frankly.
It is, if you don't know what happened next, but
you want it to be funny. Is that the competition?
I want it to be whatever you think you want to say about this picture. I've seen a few of them. I think that people are creative and hilarious. So I'm not going to micromanage what I want people to, but you know, you could imagine what might happen next, or you could just.
It's going to be tough. This is a tough competition. Now, which book do you win? Wild Connection? Is that the book?
You win Wild Connection, What Animal Courtship and Mating Tell Us About Human Relationships.
And you'll autograph it, correct?
I will sign it, with whatever you want me to say in there.
Wow.
I might want to, you know, it depends. Like, let me dial back that blanket statement.
Right.
But my
listeners will have you taking credit for the Lindbergh kidnapping. Well, we're going to be talking about animal consciousness today, and we're also going to be talking about what animals do when they think nobody is watching them. Let's show everybody this clip. We talked about this on the podcast, but we didn't get to show it to anybody. But now that we're on YouTube and we have people in the Zoom room, I want to show everybody this video of two animals who thought nobody was watching them. And Dr. Jen, what are we looking at right now?
Well, so that's a coyote. And then that's actually an American badger. And this sort of went viral. And so for a long time, scientists sort of had this anecdotal idea that coyotes and badgers formed an alliance, but we never expected that they might be friends. And so when you see in just a moment, something we might be familiar with our pet dogs, so they're clearly our pals, because this coyote now does what we all know as a play bow in dogs. And so it's an invitation to play. So this is not just sort of a random, they've tended to believe out hunting just random coyote and badger interactions. But this video really, to me, says these guys are friends. And what's amazing about that is this interspecies communication, right? So the coyote does the play bow, and there's this assumption, potentially, that the badger is going to understand coyote language.
Right.
So it's super neat, and
it looks like something out of a Disney movie. It looks like the badger would be played by Buddy Hackett. And the coyote would be played by Don Knotts. It looks like something from my childhood. And they're walking off through the tunnel to go on an adventure. What kind of adventure would they be going on? They work together?
There's been some observations of coyotes and badgers kind of cooperatively hunting. So they use really different strategies. So for example, I studied prairie dogs, and coyotes and badgers both eat prairie dogs. And that's where some observations have been made, where badgers go into the tunnels, but coyotes can't, right? So if the badger goes in, the prairie dog pops out, and then the coyote takes him, right? Or the coyote is at the burrow, so the prairie dog stays in, allowing the badger to get the prairie dog. So but it hasn't been, I've seen coyotes hunt prairie dogs and I've seen badgers hunt prairie dogs. I personally never observed them doing it together, but I was aware of it. But that's very different than let's Lady and the Tramp off into the sunset down the tunnel. You know, and I love the way the badger's just like, you know, he's just kind of a little chunky little badger, you know.
Jen, where was the film taken?
I don't know. I feel like it's probably somewhere out west, probably like Colorado, Montana, somewhere around there. So that's also where Colorado, Arizona, Montana, Wyoming, that's where a lot of the cooperative hunting.
It's incredible. It's incredible that they would be friends who work together.
Yeah.
That's absolutely.
Right? How much different can you get between a social coyote and an asocial badger, right? Mm-hmm. So completely different social structure. Badgers don't live in groups. They're pretty solitary.
Why do they call them, like, what the term, Bert, you always say to me, stop badgering me, right? Why did badgers get stuck with the being called a nudge?
Well, I mean, badgers are pretty cantankerous, right? Like the one time I encountered a badger, I had been warned that so there's also a sort of myth that they're only active at night. But I was told that if a badger comes out of its hole, you should really go the other way, like immediately. So they're pretty grumpy. They're pretty fierce. Everybody knows about the honey badger. It's been given that sort of honey badger don't give a there's a little video out about that. Honey badgers are amazing. They have a pretty big diet and they take down some I mean, they really, aside from getting honey, they also kill snakes and scorpions and I mean, you know, right? So badgers are pretty they don't shy away from a fight, right? So I don't know where "don't badger me" came from, but it's clearly not a positive statement.
Right.
And that would align with sort of the personality of badgers.
We're talking with Dr. Jennifer Verdolin, animal behaviorist, and we're also with Bert Ross, who behaves like an animal, and he's an American hero. Let's go to our next picture. We have one, I believe, of an owl playing with a deer. Is this a friendly picture? Did you take this picture?
Oh, no, I did not. So to be clear, Animals Gone Wild, candid camera of animals. So one of the tools that scientists use, and obviously hunters also use, is camera traps. And so this helps us get a glimpse of what species are living in a particular area. Camera traps. They're called camera traps.
But they trip a wire and the picture gets...
Usually they're motion censored.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Right? So you walk by it and it's, you know, and so it catches some unusual things, to say the least, right? It caught the badger and the coyote together. And
right.
Now, when you look at this, it's like, okay, I don't know that the owl is... Like maybe its eyes are bigger than its stomach, but it's been speculated that it's actually going after a rodent that's adjacent to the deer, not actually trying to attack the deer. Although some large eagles have been known to attack, you know, deer. So
right now, deer do not eat rodents. They eat vegetables only.
Right, deer eat vegetables, but right, if you're moving around at night, that's usually when rodents are also moving around at night, and that makes them super susceptible to nocturnal predators like owls. And so it could be that the deer moving through the forest, right, it disturbs the vegetation, it basically causes a mouse or other rodent, small rodent, to scurry out of the way. And owls will use a great hearing to locate. And then also they have a special visual system that allows them to sort of triangulate with sound and vision to hone in on a prey item.
Who should we be more afraid of at night, an owl or a deer?
You know, that's a tough question because you got to be afraid for different reasons. Deer can kick the hell out of you, and, you know, or gore you if they have antlers. It depends on the time of year. But an owl always, to me, I feel like owls look so upset because they have to throw up bones. And, you know, when they're born, they're fluffy little alien-like creatures that just look cute and just this ball of feathers. And then they slowly start to get, like, really angry. And they always look like they want to rip your face off. And I've decided, after studying great horned owls and picking up all of their pellets and seeing what they have to regurgitate, that I would be pretty pissed off too if that was sort of my strategy in life, was to eat things and then vomit large chunks of bone.
Right, right.
We have all the, we around my house, we have deer. I've seen a number of deer, especially this time of year when they're mating. Mm-hmm. Owls, we definitely have, we can hear them. I almost never see them.
Right.
And coyotes, too many. No,
yeah.
Bad. I haven't seen them.
Yeah, so the owls, I mean, they're not likely to attack you unless you're disrupting the nest. You know, that's about the only time that I've seen an owl look like it wanted to rip my face off. But I'd be more concerned about encountering a deer at night.
Who's more dangerous, a female owl or a male owl?
Well, females are bigger. So in all raptors, Bert, you'll love this since I know you love birds. In all
and females.
And females. So, you know, you can't say I'm big boned if you're a bird because your bones are hollow. So, you know, females are larger. Males like large females. And females love small males because small raptors fly faster and they catch more food. So the faster you fly, the better hunter you are.
Wow.
Yes.
That's so interesting.
For smaller males.
Wow. That's amazing.
Yeah.
So female owls are attracted to small males because they're better providers.
They are. And she's the one on the eggs at the nest the whole time. And he's delivering the food. It's kind of common in a lot of raptors. So females, whenever you're looking at a pair of raptors, the bigger one, if it's not a juvenile with an adult, if it's two adults, the larger one is the raptor. So I think I'm a raptor.
Wow. Why do we think owls are so smart? Why did they get that reputation?
Well, because when they look at you, they just sort of have this, I am perturbed by nothing.
Mm-hmm.
And I think we sort of equate that with calm and peacefulness and wiseness, that we're just in the face of whatever disturbance, we are simply. And then there's the eyes in the back of your head, right? They have this, I've seen it, and it's a little freaky to be first, you know, staring at the back of an owl and then you're looking at its eyes, but the
they're
rest
great
of
at basketball. Their peripheral vision, they can
make. And they play in Toronto.
Yes. The Raptors. The Raptors.
We got it.
I got it. I read your columns over at the Malibu Times.
At that low level.
That's better than anything I can come up with. I think that's amazing, Bert. Women in the owl community go after smaller men because smaller men are better providers. But what about being protected? Don't they want a strong man to protect them?
No, they can protect themselves. They need food. They're hungry. They can't hunt while they're laying on the eggs. They can't hunt. So then once the chicks are of a certain age, right, then they alternate, they go out. So same thing with osprey, bald eagles, right? So then they take turns, basically, so that the chicks aren't ever alone until they're old enough where they're not so vulnerable. And then both parents might go out and bring back food because they've got to start working double time. I mean, owl chicks don't stay small for long. It's amazing for great horned owls from the time that they're born to maybe 30, 35 days. It's incredible how much they change. They also start to get that look on their face because they're also now throwing up bones. So they go from like,
In my experience, there was a very large woman who was attracted to me. And this was back in Jersey. This was after my first marriage had ended.
But I should mention that you were a sex symbol in Bergen County.
Only to your sister, actually.
You are a sex symbol in Bergen County, New Jersey. I'm not making this up. My sister, growing up, had a picture of David Cassidy, Bobby Sherman, and Burt Ross on her wall. I'm not making that up. Women love
I was at this party, and there was a very large, tall, strong woman, and she had been married. She also was divorced to a champion heavyweight prize fighter.
Good.
Which immediately intimidated me. And people were arm wrestling, and so I thought I would show this young lady my strength. And my arm went down so fast. And I then smiled. I gave her that smug look and said, yes, but I'm a lefty. Now let's do it with our left hands. Mm. It wasn't quite as fast.
Right.
But down my arm went. And she called me with a little flirtation. She called me on the phone. And I was so intimidated that I just begged off. I mean, so.
Yeah, that's the trouble with humans, right? Like we it's interesting to me because in humans, we get intimidated. We have, we don't like to be rejected. We get all this, we have all these sort of social messaging.
I don't want to get beaten up.
She
was married to a heavyweight champion of the world.
Well, you know what? At least in Raptors, most Raptors, they're together. They have plenty of alone time, right? So Bert, here's the thing. The benefit is, like, if you're a red tail hawk, or you're a golden eagle, or you're a bald eagle, or you're an owl, a great horned owl, boy, you get plenty of alone time. You're only together. You find your partner, usually from last year, meet up in the same place. You spend some time together. You're together, like, all the time for about 4 months. And then it's like, I need some me time, and
I'm bald, so I have some alone time.
You need to tap into your inner Al, Bert. You're happily married, so I'm not going to say that to you. But men should tap into their inner Al. They see a large woman.
What does that mean?
When you see a beautiful large woman, you just go whoo whoo.
owl.
What did you think I said?
Wait a minute. There are two words. Al, which is A-L, which is what I thought you were saying, which is like the first name of Al Gore. And then Owl, O-W-L.
Okay. I'm sorry you have to see this, Dr. Jen.
And I'm just going to say, please, Bert, when you see a large woman, don't go, ow. Don't do that. That might end badly for you.
All right, let's look at our next picture. This is, I believe... squirrel. Now, what is that?
That's a flying squirrel. And I swear, deer are just getting pummeled out there by
random. Is that a squirrel?
That's a buck. If that squirrel lands on the horn, it's not going to be a happy squirrel. I can tell you that.
And it depends on where it lands.
He's going to lose his nuts, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, that's risky business right there. So it's a flying squirrel. So it doesn't have wings, but it has like a flesh, what we might think of as extra skin. Yeah. And it uses it to catch some lift. And again, looking at this, one is like, what in the world is that? Is it like a mistake? Did he think it was a branch, with the horns?
He thought it was a bullwinkle.
Are flying squirrels American?
They are. We have a couple of different flying squirrels. There's the Carolina flying squirrel, which is actually endangered.
You are.
Yeah. And then there's three different species of flying squirrel in North America. So we do have them. They're pretty tough to see. Some people, have had some as pets. I like sugar gliders are sort of related in a similar, you know, they're sort of the same. They've got that kind of extra skin and they catch air. But I'm feeling like this was a mistake for the squirrel. I'm just bad decision making, you know, because he's going to be the loser in that situation.
This is so much fun. This is a great way to spend a Saturday night. It really is.
Can you tell from the angle that it's possible, just as you were talking about how the owl, which is what I thought, the owl might be going after a rodent, but they're both in the frame, that
right.
that the angle is deceiving, and that even though it looks like he is going to land on the deer, that's not only not his intent, but that's not the direction?
I mean, that's possible. The tricky part about that, Bert, is that they should be landing on a tree, and I don't see a tree in the angle. They don't really go on the, unless it's going to go on the ground for something. So in that case, you're right. The angle, maybe it's going to land on the ground. You know,
in that angle, maybe he could land a yard in front of the deer.
That's right. I mean, still a risky proposition to startle a male deer in the middle of the night, you know, because I don't know if anybody's encountered deer when they get startled. They don't exactly behave rationally, you know.
How dangerous are we? Were looking at deer. We were in Jersey about
they're
2 weeks
all over.
And we saw the deer, and they're just, you never get tired. It never. Whenever I see deer, I just stop and they're so beautiful. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what would happen if they were cornered and you walked up to them and tried to pet them and they couldn't mm-hmm. run away.
You know, it's a good way to get kicked. It's a good way, if it's a male, to get gored. I think there was a guy who was just gored by an elk, you know, especially if it's mating season and it's a male. Mm-hmm. Like males who are horny pretty much become irrational. You know, we know that from elephants. We know that from deer, elk, moose, humans.
they're actually a bit of a problem. Before I left for the West Coast, David knows I lived in Englewood, which is only 5 minutes from the George Washington Bridge, and they were everywhere.
Sure.
There was in mating season a big buck with a doe, and I wanted to get them off my property because we have beautiful roses, etc. And he looked at me and basically with an attitude of get lost.
Sure. He doesn't want you stealing his girl.
Oh no, not at all. But there are car accidents. There are mm-hmm. people who get killed in car accidents.
Right.
And I actually went to a council meeting and talked about they're having to do something. And it's interesting, they did nothing. And I just read an article that the problem is of course getting worse. They have
no decency.
Well, they have no decency.
So
here's the thing. And one of the guests, Tamala, said this, and she's absolutely right. We got rid of all the predators. So we don't like predators, right? We don't want to coexist with wolves and mountain lions. Coyotes don't really take down adult deer. That's a tough prey thing for them, but we got rid of wolves, and getting rid of wolves meant an explosion of deer. And then you have people feeding deer. And so, you know, you create
wolves in New Jersey.
I mean, historically, right. The gray wolf was all over that area and it was exterminated. And so
how
people killed them. I mean, we still have people killing wolves, right? I mean, We have
for sport or just for out of fear? Why would you experiment?
Because they hate wolves, right? We have this whole mythology, this whole culture, and it's global. It's not just in the United States, but globally, there's been a sort of culture. And if you look at our stories about wolves, we've got right Red Riding Hood, all the movies. It's this common trope of this evil wolf, and we even have a misunderstanding about the social behavior. We still talk about the alpha wolf. There is no alpha wolf. It's a family. It's a mother, a father, and their offspring of different generations. It is not there is no alpha. And in fact, the parents co-parent, They both make decisions. Sometimes the older offspring also make decisions, but it's generally the two adults. So it's a family.
I saw a documentary, this must have been 10, 15 years ago on television, where a guy was out somewhere in the Rocky Mountains and spent months near I forget the word for a group of wolves.
Pack of wolves.
And they were very, very cautious and finally approached him. And he got friendly with them, and then he had to leave. And he came back a year or two later, not knowing whether they recognized him or what. And I don't think my dog ever gave me a warmer greeting than this pack. They howled. They literally came up and licked his face. It was extraordinary.
Wow.
Look, our dogs, right?
Yeah.
Came from directly from wolves. So it's very interesting that we have this sort of cognitive dissonance. We bred our wolves, our dogs a certain way now, especially in the last 10,000 years. But how many
generations would it take to breed a wolf down to a dog?
Not many. I mean, there's actually a great book called How to Tame a Fox and Build a Dog. Right. And so it's pretty rapid. And some people have hybrids of wolf dog hybrid. I've seen one once, and I was waitressing in Lake Worth, Florida, and I went out.
That's where my parents lived.
Oh, nice. Okay. Yeah. So I grew up in South Florida, and I was waiting tables at this Japanese restaurant in Lake Worth, and I went outside. And I looked, and I'm like, that's a wolf. And I just sort of went back inside, and I was like,
It's Florida. Of course it's a wolf.
Did I see what I thought I saw?
Florida. You'll see polar bears doing meth in Florida.
Still wolves. I saw on television the other day, I guess on Animal Kingdom. No, it was on that show where about Alaska, where they're out in the... And the fellow had killed... In one winter, I think 20 or 30 wolves for the pelts. And you can see all the pelts hanging up and drying out. Apparently they kill
a lot. Still have bounty hunting for coyotes. And the thing is, when you kill coyotes, they just make more. They actually have, we know that the more you kill coyotes, the more coyotes breed. So killing coyotes, in fact, the best way to control coyotes is to have wolves. Wolves will take out coyotes. And also the way to manage mountain lions is to allow wolves back into the system. So they're competitors. They compete for prey with both mountain lions and wolves. And most of the time, mountain lions, the most problems that people have with mountain lions are in places where they kill mountain lions. Otherwise, mountain lions, you guys have in California, Griffith Park, you've got that male, I think it's P46.
Yep.
He's pretty famous. He's been on his own. He's stuck on an island, basically. And he very rarely goes into neighborhoods. It's pretty rare. And he skirts just the edges of Griffith Park.
Well, we have in Malibu, we definitely have mountain lions. And sometimes they kill people's pets. The big problem with them around here is that the poison that people use to kill rats,
mm-hmm.
then they eat the dead rats.
Right.
And then they die. The other, of course, major way is the our cars.
Yes. Well, because they have to
cross,
I
wanted to ask you about that. By the way,
we're highways to get out, you know.
We're talking with Dr. Jennifer Verdolin. She's an internationally recognized animal behavior expert. Two books, Wild Connection, What Animal Courtship and Mating Tell Us About Human Relationships, and Raised by Animals, The Surprising New Science of Animal Family Dynamics with Try-at-Home Lessons from the Wild. She is also a professor. You teach animal behavior or animal ecology. What are you teaching this year?
So I teach a lot. Right now I'm teaching wildlife conservation and American culture, but I define America as it is geographically, North, South, Central America. And then I teach wildlife conservation behavior. We call it ecological sampling. It's basically how do we go out there and count stuff. Camera traps is one way that we can count stuff that it's hard to find.
And poop.
Oh, poop and footprints are pretty much a staple. Like I have a PhD piled higher and deeper in a bunch of poop. I mean, you can tell a lot from poop. You can tell diet, hormones, pregnancy. You can tell individual genetics. I mean, I became an expert at extracting DNA from poop.
But Dan, our executive producer, is telling us we have to move along very quickly before we get to the next picture. Thank you, Dan. Dan Frankenberger is in charge of my life. I was told by a hunter that most of the deer you see on the side of the road during rutting season are females who have been surprised by the bucks, and they don't want to be intimate, and they bolt away from the buck and they end up getting hit by a car. That usually when you hit a deer, it's a female deer who's running away from a male.
Well, I would agree that it's mostly female deer that you hit. I mean, you have disproportionate number of females to males in deer. So, you know, unless you were there to know what happened, one could say it's just a sex ratio difference because, you know, most deer males, they don't quite make it. It takes a lot of energy to be a male. You got to get bigger. You go divert all that energy to grow your bone. The antlers are bone. And so it's about 30% more energy that you need to get to grow your antlers.
Do they grow back if you get them?
They fall off every year, right? And then next year you're bigger, you grow them bigger and so on and so on. And so they fall off. And in deer, both sexes don't have them. In American antelope, both sexes have antlers, right? And so they stay pretty small. And they don't fall off every year. They're constant. So you know, it is possible. It could be a consequence of different numbers of males and females. But in general, females tend to run away from males when they don't want to be intimate. And yeah, it usually leads them into dangerous
experience.
I'm sorry, Bert?
I had that experience.
With female deer?
No, of females running away from me.
Okay.
I have a question. In our men and women, women tend to outlive men.
Yes.
Is that common in the animal world? And if so, does anybody know why?
Okay, there's a couple reasons. I actually am on a paper that talks about this. So this is a great question. In general, there's a couple of ideas why. In some species, you know, males live fast, die young, right? And so risky behavior is more common in males, in humans as well. That's why you guys get charged more for car insurance when you're in your 20s, right, than we do. Testosterone is kind of costly. So we know that testosterone leads to, health problems. It's not a cheap hormone to produce a lot of. And in fact, what we're seeing
Doesn't estrogen cause cancer for some women, ovarian cancer, whatever, breast cancer?
Well, so estrogen, you know, replacement hormones tend to do that. But yes, so there is a type of breast cancer that is hormone related, right? But in general, and we have testosterone too, but the amount that we have is a lot lower and in general. And so the thing with we're seeing even now with the pandemic, right? Males are more at risk. And in fact, reproductive aged males are at risk for sterility because the testicles actually is where there's a concentration of those ACE2 receptors, which is what the virus binds to. So they speculate that the testosterone, right, is what is leading this differential in male survival for coronavirus. And also males have to fight a lot. Like, I don't know if you notice, right? Like you guys like fight a lot. And in other species, males try to avoid physical combat as much as possible, but sometimes it's unavoidable. And so you have sort of death that comes from having to fight so much. And so there's a lot of reasons why males die young in all kinds of species or younger than females. But females, we have to pay the cost of reproduction. So a great sort of equalizer is that having children physically, the physical toll of reproduction, if you take a female that has never reproduced in another species and one that has reproduced, the one who does not reproduce will live longer and be physically healthier than the one that has reproduced.
Okay, you said something that could be a public service. If the men in this country, white supremacists, kind of Trumpster men, knew that COVID might impact their testicles,
right.
I think they'd wear masks.
I think if they had testicles, testicles, they wouldn't be voting for Trump. They wouldn't be carrying those guns.
But let's not let them know. Like the more they get sterile, maybe the better.
I promised tonight we were going to take a brief rest.
I know. Okay. Let's go to the next picture.
Yes. Next picture, please. Something clean. This is good. Get your kids, gather around.
No.
Who doesn't love a porcupine? This is sweet.
Don't gather your children.
Dogs don't love porcupines.
I'm sorry?
Dogs don't love porcupines.
But those are beautiful porcupines.
Anyone tries to bite a porcupine doesn't love a porcupine.
Well, those porcupines look like me right after my hair transplants.
porcupines, you're right, Bert. Like dogs don't like them. Lions don't like them. Oh, they learn pretty quick that you don't want to mess with a porcupine. But here we have two porcupines caught in the evening. I don't know what they're doing, but I do know that porcupines, because of these very dangerous spines, have to do it face to face.
Just like the way God intended it to be.
Is the male bigger there on the photo, looking at it to the right?
I don't know the gender of these two, and I don't know about sexual dimorphism, which is the sort of technical term for whether males are bigger than females. My guess is probably males are bigger than females in porcupines because they do all the sort of ritual stuff, which...
I can tell the female porcupine from the male. The female one is the one without the pricks. Sorry.
We're not supposed to talk about
Trump. Just beat me to that. The terrible minds think alike.
We're not supposed to talk about Trump, but he shares something maybe in common with the porcupines.
What?
Part of the mating ritual for porcupines is the male pees on the female. So you have golden showers. Except I think in his case, it was the reverse.
Oh, hang on. The audience was applauding that. The mating ritual.
That's why I agreed to be on this show. it's that kind of increase in my knowledge of that. I'm just happy to be part of it.
So you're saying that porcupines... pee on the female.
On a potential mate, they pee on her.
And do they get photographed by Vladimir Putin?
In the human case, it's kind of the reverse, and at least with Trump, but R. Kelly would be a completely different situation.
Right.
But porcupines aren't they're American porcupines, so it's homegrown, fetish here. But we do have other examples. So in capuchin monkeys, the males will pee on themselves, actually, as a way to attract the females. They kind of rub it all over, and say, okay, I'm ready.
Really?
Oh, yeah. They pee on their hands . So I feel really lucky to be human and not have a porcupine issue.
You're happy you're not a Russian hooker. On the right.
That too.
On the right. It seems like the one is much more aroused. All are up and the other is back.
So I'm going to guess, if I had to guess, I would say that the one that's you know, spines up is the male.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking. And bigger.
Yeah. I mean,
urine is an aphrodisiac for, you say, capuchin monkeys?
Capuchin monkeys and porcupines, clearly. But, you know, I mean, and then you have the reverse, you know, like giraffes, the female will spray the male's, you know, he gets all up in there when she's peeing because he's trying to figure out if she's interested or ready, you know. So I think.
Does she complain that he keeps missing? How many times do I have to tell you? Hit the target when you pee.
Well, she's the one peeing on him in that case. You know, I mean, I would say I feel glad to be human, but we obviously, you know.
The giraffe's got to bend down. The giraffe's got to really bend down.
He's got to get up in there, you know. Yeah. That's also how he flirts, is he nudges her in the butt. So
I went on safari many years ago. It's something I'd really like to do again.
Have you tried chrome? Chrome instead of Safari? I have no shame, Bert. Go ahead.
I don't even get it.
Just move on. Just move pretend on. It didn't happen.
And I'm driving in the Jeep, and I notice literally above the trees, just the head of the giraffe. And it's kind of an amazing sight. And I yelled to the driver, stop, you know, and just watched as it moved. This head moved along, and they get eaten by lions, giraffes.
Sure. Well, mostly when they got to get down to drink. But before, I was just wondering, David, did you know that giraffes are browsers?
And not giraffes grazers? Are browsers?
They are browsers, not grazers. So there was another layer to your
leaves.
They eat leaves, so they're browsers, and they're not grazers. So
they
grazers.
Have. By the way, they eat a very thorny tree from a thorny tree, and their tongues are so extraordinary the way they can wrap around that they're able to eat these leaves and all from this tree without puncturing their tongue.
Yeah, that's the acacia tree. No, it's the acacia tree. And there's an interesting relationship on acacias with ants too. They kind of have a little sort of defense system. But giraffes, Bert, what you were saying that lions eat them. So in general, they're super vulnerable when they gotta get down to drink water, and they can actually pass out if they get up too fast.
Sometimes they're chased and they trip, and the minute they trip, they're goners. And we came to a kill where all we saw were these four huge legs, and the lions were so satiated that when we got there, they barely were able to lift their heads.
Yeah, it's like Thanksgiving for lions.
Yeah, exactly.
Are giraffes endangered?
Yes, they are actually. Several species are endangered.
How would they survive? I mean, evolutionarily speaking, how does a giraffe explain itself?
Well, I don't know what that means. Like,
how does it survive?
It eats food. They actually are pretty cool. They have social networks. So they have what one study found, that all giraffes in a particular area were actually connected. They got their feeding friends. They have their water friends. They've got their babysitting friends. So the females have like little babysitting, daycare centers, right? Where they leave several females will look over all the young while another mom goes off to eat. Mm-hmm. So
perhaps they've evolved the height so that they have a food source that very few other animals can get to.
Well, right. So we call that sort of niche partitioning, right? So mm-hmm. basically to avoid competition, you know, the environment kind of gets segregated into different niches. So think about our economy, right? Like we have different niches, what people specialize in. And if you have too much, I think there was a book called Blue Ocean Strategy, right? If there's too much competition, then you can't quite set yourself apart. So you specialize or you develop a new skill where there's nobody there. And that's one of the ideas for why we have so many beetles. So when flowering plants emerged, beetles were able to capitalize on a new resource, and they exploded in diversity. There's so many beetles. It's kind of ridiculous how many beetles there are.
Okay, let's move on to the next picture before Dan gets mad at me. Okay.
The bear is playing.
Yeah. I mean, that's one sexy bear. But again, like, well, I mean, what is this bear doing? I mean, presumably he didn't know the camera was there.
Is that that's a male bear, right?
Well, I haven't zoomed in, so I don't really know. And I don't know how prominent male bear body parts are.
You wouldn't think that a bear would sleep on its back.
Why not? I mean, probably not out in the open.
A lot of animals don't sleep on their back. That's kind of
because sleep.
You don't expose your belly, right? Bert, I think that's what you're getting at. Like, your belly is where you can get eviscerated. It's also why many humans don't like to have their stomach massaged. Do you ever notice when you go get a massage, wherever they go, they typically don't go to your stomach. We tend to not like it. And neither do most animals, right? Not all dogs. And it's a good way to, you know, so sometimes they like it, some dogs like it, but, and they sort of suggest it as a way to tell personality and sort of how easygoing your dog is. If it lets you pet its belly. I mean, Señor Antonio Botones, it depends on his mood. Every now and then he really loves to let you get in there on his belly, but it's, I know I'm talking about you. So, you know, but you're right, Bert, most animals don't sleep on their back.
Bears are
It also seems to me that animals are amazing in, unlike humans, by the way, that most animals, if they're sleeping and they hear a noise, they can be gone in a minute. There was a deer very near here the other day. It was a buck, and he dug some ground out and then lay down in the shade. So if you dig, you'll see a dog do that too. Many animals, they'll dig the ground because it's a little cooler. And then he'll lie down. And then another animal came, and I couldn't tell if it was a female or a buck, around the bend, and the one lying down could not smell that deer and couldn't see. And all of a sudden there was a little bit not a mudslide because it was dry. And immediately the one that was taking a nap bolted. Mm-hmm. But if you're lying on your back, you have to flip around. You're losing a second or two. Humans, by the way, it's interesting. If you heard a noise, you might sit up, but you're not bolting fast. It takes a little longer for humans to react versus most animals, I think.
I mean, it depends, right? So the interesting thing that I've thought about, and I wrote about this in Raised by Animals, is like, we're social. Most social animals don't sleep alone at all. They sleep together because sleeping alone is super risky. And we sort of impose and force this on infants when we haven't evolved to be sleeping alone. And I don't know, Bert, I'm as a child, I had somebody break into our house. I knew two girls, their mom was murdered when they were sleeping. So I tend to bolt. So I had somebody who was drunk one night pounding on a window. It was 3 o'clock in the morning. I shot up and I bolted into the kitchen and grabbed a knife and crouched in the corner. And then it came around to the front door. I called the police, and 7 minutes later, the police came, and it turned out the guy was drunk. And I will give him credit for this. The next day I had 2 bags of chocolate truffles and a card apologizing that he was at the wrong door. Fortunately, I never had to see him, but I shot up like a rocket.
Do you sleep soundly?
Well, I don't think I've slept soundly in 17 years, thanks to this guy right over here. So Senor Buttons really enjoys stepping on my face, pulling out my hair while I'm sleeping. You believe
that the average human arises out of sleep as fast as most animals?
No, absolutely not. And you know what? Most social animals don't have to either, right? So when you sleep together in a group, you're just generally more protected. And so I think that, and for many humans in most of the world, they are not in all these separate rooms or sleeping in big houses alone. The whole family is in one or two rooms. And so I think that we have created a sort of situation that doesn't allow us to sleep soundly because we're incredibly vulnerable. And we know that we're vulnerable somewhere deep down inside.
Now, when they hibernate, bears hibernate, they hibernate in caves? Do they hibernate in groups?
No, they hibernate in dens mostly.
When you say a den?
A bear.
Well, so no bears actually hibernate socially together because bears aren't social, right? So wherever you are, hibernation is going to be triggered by different things. But like it was Fat Bear Week last week, and the winner is this Kodiak bear. I mean, if only one could just indulge like that, right? But so usually have a threshold of weight that they hit, and then they go in.
Where do they go though?
They have a den, you know.
When you say a den, like a hole, a what?
In the rocks, they'll make. It depends. Polar bears can do it practically in the snow. They'll dig a hole. They normally go to higher ground. Often, grizzly bears will go up into the mountains a bit.
And how long do they sleep for?
Again, it depends, right? So polar bears, the females, they are in a tough spot because they have their cubs when they're hibernating. So then they'll wake up and they'll stay in the ice igloo den. It's basically an igloo for up to 3 months. And they're pretty hungry when they come out. And so it depends, right, on where you are in terms of
latitude.
Well,
this bear that we're looking at, this guy.
Yeah, I think that's a black bear.
So he just crawls in between some rocks and sleeps it off?
Well, so they can use dens that other animals have. Like, so a lot of animals like rabbits, I don't know why we say a rabbit hole, because the rabbits don't dig their own holes. They co-opt holes that are created by other animals. So, you know, coyotes have dens when they have their pups. Foxes have dens. And so it's entirely possible that for some bears, they find an existing den that was created.
And if you wake that bear up while he's hibernating, does he bolt and attack?
No, they don't. I mean, in fact, there was some footage maybe last year, this father and son just killed a bear that was hibernating. They went in, woke it up and just shot him. So they don't, their metabolic rate has slowed. They don't come out of hibernation that quickly, right? I will say that you know, lots of animals use the structures that are made by others. I mean, badgers don't. They can dig. They're powerful diggers, but they use prairie dog burrows. They just make them bigger. You know,
it moves a lot of weight.
Yes.
When a bear hibernates like four months or whatever, they can lose a third of their body weight or more. It's
that's right. So they tend to basically eat until they hit a target rate, weight. And it's sort of like we do with retirement savings. There's this weight that they hit and then they go in to hibernation. Same thing with prairie dogs. They actually, Gunnison's prairie dogs are obligate hibernators. And so when they hit about 1900 grams, almost 2,000 grams, 2 kilograms, they'll go into hibernation.
Okay.
The grizzly bears just gorge themselves.
They do.
Before they go into hibernation. They can't put it away fast enough.
I know.
And they're coming back, right? They've tripled their population in parts of Montana, the grizzly bear, right?
They've done well in areas where they've been protected, but it's taken a long time because they're slow breeders and the cubs' survival rate is pretty low. So they tend to just replace themselves.
Grizzly bears where I was, they were averaging about two cubs. Some of them even had three.
Yeah, but that doesn't mean those cubs all survive to adulthood and reproduce,
sometimes
right?
Eaten by the males. Killed, huh? Not eaten, but killed by the males.
Yeah, and in fact, it's really interesting. In Sweden, the brown bears have adapted. The females actually go close to people because that protects them from aggressive males. So they're using humans, you know, sort of the enemy of my enemy is my friend strategy. So they go closer to town with young cubs because it keeps the male bears away.
Okay, let's go to the next slide, please.
My favorite. He actually likes the way he looks.
He does, like lesson in self-acceptance right here.
No embarrassment at all. He's not saying, I need to have some crowns in my, some of these teeth were placed. No, he is absolutely content with the way he is.
And I will say, this is a crested macaque and he took his own picture. So.
It's a selfie.
He took a selfie and crested macaques are pretty.
<It's a> man.
And so the interesting thing about this is that this picture was at the center of a landmark copyright dispute.
Right.
The photographer who was taking pictures of crested macaques did not take this picture. It went viral and everybody was using it. And he sued for copyright infringement. And a judge said, nope, only partial. It was your camera, but he took his own picture. So you don't get 100% copyright. The monkey has copyright.
You know, it doesn't seem to have, if you look at the lower teeth, they don't see, he doesn't seem to have fangs.
Yeah, no, it's interesting, right? So you can see a little, it could be a young one too. You got little ones, I would point, but nobody can see me. Yeah. But crested macaques, they don't eat meat, right? And they're also pretty peaceful, cooperative, non-violent, non-aggressive. So you don't have this like huge, like in baboons where you've got some, especially in some species like the Hamadryas baboons or the mandrills where the males have these enormous fangs and they will eat meat. They hunt small antelope sometimes, but it's really also for display against each other, and it's a highly competitive environment. So the crested macaques, what's not to love about this, right? I mean, it just gives you a sense of they're kind of, I wouldn't approach them, but they're kind of relaxed, happy-go-lucky crested macaques.
Baboon. Amazing. We were driving in South Africa near outside of Cape Town, mm-hmm. and a teenage girl came out screaming, and the driver, they spoke Afrikaner, that a male baboon was in the house, had gotten into the kitchen with grandma. And I gave the guy my walking sticks, which if you take the tips off, they have a spike. Mm-hmm. And he chased it out, but they are extremely mean, and you're not allowed to kill them.
Right. Well, so I will say that I wouldn't agree that they're mean, but their social system is one in which it's kind of despotic, and we are all familiar with that. We're in one right now. We're having a despotic sort of social order, and we can see how aggressive, violent, and unpleasant that is. And so, you know, so I always reframe, you know, that they're not mean in the sense that we are mean, right? They're not gratuitously mean. They are fighting for defending resources that they believe should be theirs.
Great.
If it's off subject, but I think it's a philosophical, I think it's the question. Our population in my lifetime is considerably more than double. And how do we preserve the habitat for all these species? And you take a lot of these countries in Africa, you talk about Brazil, and it's easy for, you know, people in our country to say, well, they should not allow the following.
Right.
Well, the problem is we have the industry,
right?
We have the money, and in many of these countries, they need the resource. I flew over an island in Indonesia, and they were just burning that whole island, a fairly large island. I guess they'll plant, for trees for the palm oil. But unless, I don't know the solution, because you can't tell these people, you know, it's bad for the earth,
right,
for you to develop your land,
right,
and yet it is damaging to the country, to the world. So unless you create a world fund and give immense amounts of money to these countries to set aside this land, and it's not going to be peanuts, I don't see a solution. I think ultimately the population continues to expand, and these animals are in trouble.
Oh, I mean, well, you know, there's a lot packed in there, right?
Yeah.
So, and I would just say there's a couple issues, and it's all very complex. One, we have not stopped destroying our own habitat. So it's rather hypocritical to go somewhere else and try to import or export the American model of conservation, which is not functional for people who need to use those resources. Community-based conservation has worked much better, and that's where people can still use the resource, but they're invested in a way that creates more sustainability. But really, corporate interests are driving a lot of destruction, and I would say that at one level, we participate in purchasing products. I mean, palm oil is an example. So anybody who wants to say anything about what's going on in Indonesia with the peat bogs and the burning and killing of orangutans and human slavery that is involved in palm oil, well, then I hope you check all your products, because palm oil is in a lot of things. And unless you commit to never purchasing or putting your money into anything that contains palm oil, you don't necessarily have a lot to say, you know, realistically.
Again, they're going to do, so if it's not palm oil, it's going to be something else.
Oh,
if
I understand.
We have jungle,
right?
And we have, you know, all the luxuries that we have isn't going to cut it for the rest of the world.
Oh no, but look, I mean, you're right. It's sharks. I mean, an article just came out, 500,000 sharks are likely to be killed for the coronavirus vaccine because we use squalene, which is found an oil in sharks as an adjuvant, I forget the right word, to enhance the immune response of vaccines. But people didn't know that. So guess what? There is a non-animal alternative, olive oil and other plant-based alternatives. But the reason they're not used is because they cost more, right? So as long as you want to pay less for something, and the whole system is created.
I would think catching sharks would be more expensive than growing olives.
Nope.
Let's move on to our next picture. Dan,
we do. We have a couple.
The
more.
Game of Thrones, but maybe.
Oh yes, on the feral pit.
Yeah, but we'll do this. Why don't we answer some listener questions, and
yes,
then we will wrap this up. This is fantastic. If you'd like to join us in the Zoom room, go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the attend a live taping, and then you can come and sit in our Zoom audience and ask questions. And to our Zoom audience, raise your hand if you want to ask Dr. Jen a question. This one is really interesting. Paul asks, how realistic are the Planet of the Apes movies behavior-wise? Because certainly Charlton Heston's toupee is not anything.
Well, you know, I thank you, Paul, for the question. And I bet Paul didn't know that I have a little inside knowledge about this. So I think last time I was on, we talked about the Center for Great Apes that had was a sanctuary I worked at for many years for chimpanzees and orangutans. And the actress who played one of the orangutans spent a tremendous amount of time there studying the orangutans. So on the micro scale of sort of movements and behaviors, spot on in many cases. On the bigger picture, I think is maybe what Paul is getting at of how, I don't know, right? But first of all, right, it's not realistic at all in the sense that gorillas, chimps, and orangutans don't interact. And they wouldn't interact. And so that kind of aspect of the story is not realistic. And I think that, you know, so I don't quite know how to answer that except on a micro scale of behavior, the movements, the physical sort of facial expressions, those kinds of things, very accurate. But in the big scheme of things, you know, obviously not really accurate.
Okay, Dan, they put up the wrong picture. This is from our Christmas party at the David Feldman Show last year. Can you put the right picture up? That's me. I had a little too much. So what do we look at? Bert, before Dr. Jen tells us what we're looking at. Thank you, Dan. I can tell you what you're looking at. What are we looking at?
We're looking at a raccoon.
Yeah.
On top, hitching a ride.
Right.
Lazy, like a parasite, hitching a ride on an enormous feral wild boar.
Mm-hmm.
And in front of them on the ground looks like an, I don't know why it's spelled opossum, but everybody says possum.
Well, the opossums are from Ireland.
Very good. And so is it pronounced possum or opossum?
So I always say possum, but like you, Bert, I've never Googled it. I'm sure there's an answer on Google, but I often have also wondered why is it spelled opossum, but we say possum.
They are, to me, because I'm not an animal behaviorist and I'm not the mother of a possum, unusually ugly animals whose major defense, because they seem unlike a porcupine with the quills or a skunk with the smell, they are pretty much defenseless. And so they play dead,
right.
Ugly and dead, which to me doesn't seem like a great defense, but sometimes in war, people play dead and they don't get shot. Sometimes mm-hmm. they get shot again. So,
well, so I'm very familiar with thanatosis, which is the technical term for playing possum. And
thanatosis?
Thanatosis. It's playing
love
dead.
Of death. Freud talks about thanatosis.
Sounds like what you used to take mouthwash for. And that was halitosis. Oh.
So thanatosis is the technical term. I have personal experience with this as I've done it 3 times in my life. But Bert, I just want to say that while they may not be pretty, so Senor Buttons is getting insistent. While they may not be pretty.
Hang on for 1 second. Hang on. Does Senor Buttons want to go outside?
He does. There's a covered patio. It's enclosed and screened, and we go out together. But he is, I made the mistake of letting him out in the evening once. And so now apparently that's a thing we do.
Now it's raining. You're going to let him go out in his white shoes? They're going to be covered in mud.
Well, it's an enclosed patio. It's not wet. Oh. But anyway,
rain?
So
you have rain?
Yeah,
is
we have rain.
Rain and
we haven't
cat?
Had rain in 7 months. So it's,
I know. I just left Arizona, where they still don't have any rain. So so possums, I think, are cute, but they're really neat. They have quadruplets, so they're all identical. For some one species, they just have 4 identical babies. But they eat ticks. So they're super useful, especially on the East Coast with Lyme disease. You want to have possums, you know, and thanatosis is an excellent strategy. Great white sharks do it. Sharks in general do thanatosis. I wouldn't recommend that you try this at home. but if you flip a shark over on its back, it will go into thanatosis. And this is how orcas kill them. So they turn them over. And if you keep an animal long enough, including humans, because we're animals, in thanatosis,
do chickens do chickens do thanatosis? Is that how you hypnotize a chicken?
I don't know. I've never heard of
chickens. How about alligators?
That I don't know. I mean, I know that it's a strategy for both prey and predators. You know, you see the antelope and lion. There's been videos of that where the lion is there and then the antelope just. And most predators don't want to eat dead things. So they get sort of, okay, it's dead. And then they look away and it shoots up.
I thought lions were perfectly happy eating dead. No?
No, mountain lions are scavengers. So, but I'm talking about African lions generally don't scavenge. Maybe males do, but for the most part, most big cats, mountain lions do scavenge. So that's where they sometimes get blamed for things they didn't kill, because they will scavenge about 30% of the time.
Okay, let's go to our next question. And it is a cat question. Before we get to that, so this is just a boar?
Oh, with a rat. Yeah. So basically, as you were saying, Bert, this is a raccoon on the back of a boar. There's a possum in the foreground. And, you know, boars are kind of, you know, not the smartest things if we're going to talk intelligence. And so not particularly concerned about the and raccoons, we know, are fairly clever. But a little digging into this photo told me that there was a feeder and that the raccoon can't reach it and neither can the possum and neither can the boar. So here again, we have interspecies cooperation potentially to be reaching, like, the feeder. Now the boar also will kill a raccoon, so that raccoon is probably in the safest position, because boars, you know, I mean, I was more afraid of javelina when I was in Tucson than I ever would be of a mountain lion or coyote or a bobcat.
What is javelina?
Javelina are they're peccaries, so they're not pigs, but people often think they are. And so they're found in Arizona all the way down south into South America. And they are like boars, but they don't have very good eyesight, but they have a keen sense of smell. And so you know, something like, well, the analog in Africa, on the African continent, is the water buffalo. It is the most dangerous animal, more so that second maybe hippo. You know, before a lion. So not being able to see well and smell well, and the fact that you can smell well and that you run fast makes you pretty darn dangerous. So I always, javelina was the only thing that made me turn around and go the other way.
Okay. Nancy asks, do animals get high or drunk in the wild? We've talked about this. It's bizarre.
We're
talking about the dolphins, right?
Yeah, but it's more common than you might think, right? So drunk is, well, there's a couple levels of drunk. So you've got some chimpanzees that are notorious for raiding a village palm wine. So there's a fermented juice that comes out of this palm, and they go and they get drunk, and then it's just complete mayhem. Then you have birds like cedar waxwings and probably other birds that, as the berries are ripening, they can sometimes get overripe. And I wonder if butterflies ever get drunk, because if you leave out fermented sort of a soupy banana, I mean, the alcohol content, right? I mean, I made banana bread once, because what else do you do with overripe bananas? And somebody said, did you put rum in this? You know, because they had gone there. So I don't know if butterflies get drunk. But birds certainly do, and then they can't fly. they run into things. They
unless they're with Northwest Airlines.
I
hate myself.
There's certainly other plants that cause, altered states, and animals are known to eat them. And I mean, right. So, and sometimes it's for medicinal properties, and other times, I don't know if they know, but there's been some evidence to suggest some overconsumption by some animals. It never leads to good things. Don't fly and drink. Don't build a nest in a tree if you're a chimp and drink.
Should we let animals vote?
I'm sorry?
Should we let animals vote, and would we do better if we did?
Well, animals do vote in their own social groups a lot. I think that here's the thing, right? Maybe instead of letting, deciding whether we let other animals vote for us, maybe we could just not suppress the vote. I don't know. Like, that's just a thought.
Well, yes. I thought that actually animals might be brighter.
Well, we talked about this. They cough. Don't certain gorillas
cough? Yeah,
well,
they make pretty good decisions. And I will say this for Canada geese, as much as some people don't like them because they think they poop on everything,
They do.
I know, but then they are also fed. And so, we are responsible for a lot of the things we don't like. So Canada geese, they will go with consensus of the flock, right? And if they can't agree, they go in different directions. But one thing is for sure, they do not follow someone that they think doesn't know where they're going. So in that sense, Bert, I think if we let Canada geese, make the call, we might end up in a better direction.
Or Canada.
The next time we're on, please ask me about the last time I played golf, and it relates to Canadian geese, but anyway.
Okay, and it's Canada geese, technically.
Yes.
Okay.
You're right.
We are going to take two questions about pets.
Okay.
You're an animal behaviorist. We don't talk too much about cats and dogs with you. Some of our listeners had some cats and dog questions for you.
Sure.
As I understand it, cats are kept as pets. Is that correct?
Or they keep us as pets. I can't decide.
Doug asks, Dr. Jen, how do I stop the neighborhood cats from marking my front door? I would assume that's pee.
Sure. I would collect some coyote urine and put that out front. But, that's my solution. Or get a human male to pee outside your front door, but that's not going to take care of the smell. So I don't know if the person has a pet, a cat, and that female, maybe they have a male or female cat. I'm not sure. What I can say is that usually the best deterrent is the scent of something else that they don't want to be near.
How about a sign that just says occupado? Occupied, maybe. All right.
Yeah, I mean, that's a tough one. There's something that they're being attracted to. And once they start, it's pretty hard to stop. And if it's a male who's not neutered, boy, that's going to stink.
Yeah.
Makes my nose kind of curl up.
Maybe your front door, the cats are marking the front door. Maybe the front door is too nice. Don't cats know what you spent money on and they kind of go for it? That's been my experience with cats, that they can find the most expensive clothes,
right,
the most expensive couch, and they just hone in on it.
Well, I will say this, that Senor Buttons is pretty good about not clawing up anything, really. He scratches on his post, and I usually have to cut his nails because he's pretty lazy about that. But I just got this chair. I was really happy. I got my little mid-century, modern replica. It's not a real one. Chair. And he immediately clawed up the corner. And I was like, I finally made the decision to get a chair. Even though I'm not having company over because we're in a pandemic, I want seating. And he just clawed it. So I usually cover that corner out of sight, out of mind. That's the beautiful thing about most other species is when we were camping across country and he was fixated on something outside the tent, which was not sealed, I just put a blanket over his tent and all of a sudden he was like, oh, okay. Mm-hmm. You know, we tend to still obsess over things we can't see anymore.
Okay. Bert, do you have a cat?
No, I had a cat and it was kind of a disastrous situation. It didn't work out well.
I'm sorry.
Do you have a dog?
I'm much more a dog person.
I've had easily 25 cats in my life.
I've had dogs and cats, so I've gotten a taste of it. I had a Great Dane, and I'll tell you, he ate my Oakley sunglasses. He destroyed more expensive things than all three of my cats combined.
Okay. Last question. This comes to us from Sharon. She says she has an elderly cat. The elderly cat eats well and is very healthy. However, she lets out a blood-curdling scream several times a day.
Yeah.
Apparently, she's done this her whole life. We adopted her almost 4 years ago, but have been familiar with her about 10 years ago. She belonged to my son's roommate. We offered to take her during the roommate's pregnancy. Any ideas? Oh, the roommate was pregnant, so you can't have cats?
They usually advise women to, you can have cats, but you're not supposed to clean the litter box. So toxoplasmosis is a parasite that is pretty
rampant,
common in cats because they get it from either water sources outside or uncooked meat. It's not just in cats. Humans get infected with it.
Isn't it an epidemic? Don't they say that it alters your brain chemistry and makes you think crazy thoughts?
Getting another cat? You can take risks, be more risky if you're male, like gamble more. But in fact, human females are more attracted. Well, the research isn't 100%. And I actually just will be putting out a blog on how parasites manipulate us because I just thought it was sort of appropriate, right? How do we buffer from being behaviorally manipulated by parasites? Kind of a follow-up to the kleptoparasite. And so toxoplasmosis, it's most notorious for making rats unafraid of cats, of course. Instead of fleeing from something that's dangerous, you run towards it, which I think we can all agree is probably, you're choosing something that's against your own, you're not even choosing it. You just don't know that you're being manipulated into doing that. So the toxoplasmosis does this by causing lesions on the amygdala, which is your fear sort of response center in your brain. For pregnant women, it can be problematic. So they generally recommend not cleaning the litter box. It doesn't mean that you can't have cats, but I don't know, Button's mom used to, but it wasn't until she was older. So the fact that this cat has done this its whole life, potentially, maybe if it's the same time of day, not sure what's going on. For senior cats, if it's something new, they call it kind of like kitty Alzheimer's. Sometimes it can be hyperthyroidism causes an elevated blood pressure and they will vocalize like that. But if this cat's been doing it for a decade or more, I don't know other than, sometimes they get routines and maybe it's its way of saying, hello, I would like something right now. And they want it at the same time every day.
Do they sing?
You can't teach an old cat new tricks.
I disagree. I just taught Senor Buttons how to camp. Oh. So, and he's 17. That's pretty old for a cat.
Well, the only reason I said it was not because of its literal meaning, but because it's a distortion of the expression you can't teach a dog.
Oh, I know. Well, I took it literal because, I want to stand up for I want to stand up for senior cats everywhere.
Right. Dr. Jennifer Verdolin is a professor in the Natural Science Department over at the University of Arizona. She is also an author of two fantastic books, wild connection, what animal courtship and mating tell us about human relationships, as well as Raised by Animals, the surprising new science of animal family dynamics with try-at-home lessons from the wild. And you should subscribe to her YouTube channel, Wild Connection TV. Go to jenniferverdolin.com, sign up for her newsletter, and follow the good doctor on Twitter at RealDrJen. We need to do this. This was fantastic. What a great way to spend a Saturday night. Bert Ross, yes, as always, thank you. The three of us should just keep doing this.
I would love to. And Bert, you're the coolest cat in town.
Ooh.
Even if you're a dog person.
I'm a dog person.
Very clever. Very clever.
Thank you, Dr. Jennifer Verdolin, and thank you, Bert Ross. We're going to do this again, and I want to thank you.
Thank you for everybody coming. Oh, my
stay,
gosh.
Stay. Let me just say goodbye to everybody, and then we'll talk afterwards if you can. I want to thank everybody who attended this via Zoom. If you would like to sit in our Zoom virtual audience and ask questions, go to davidfeldmanshow.com, hit the attend a live taping. We are doing a pay-per-view event a week from tonight at 9:30, the COVID Town Squares, with immunobiologist Henry Huckamacki and the irritable immunologist. And we're going to talk about COVID-19, as always. Thank you to Dan Frankenberger. We cannot do this without our executive producer, Dan Frankenberger. I will see everybody Monday when we record another episode of the David Feldman Show. And if you'd like to sit in our virtual studio audience, you know what to do. And we'll be doing the live taping on YouTube, and that podcast drops Tuesday morning at 3 a.m.
You two froze, and I'm
frozen?
Bert, you're frozen.
You're frozen. Thank you, everybody.